I'm William Cooper, and you're listening to The Hour of the Time. Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, you're going to have a montage, part musical, part educational, extremely illuminating. Starring the Resistance Band with Dana Bonner, Jackie Burris, Craig Seabury, Shane Eden, Tom Landon, Pete Perk, Dana Sambalon, songs arranged by the mysterious Z, Tom Landon, Craig Seabury, and Dana Sambalon. Starring William Cooper, Stanton T. Friedman, Richard Burton, Julie Covington, David Essex, Justin Hayward, Bill Lynott, Joe Partridge, and Chris Thompson in Jeff Wayne's musical version of The War of the Worlds. Thank you.
in lava land.
No one would have believed in the last years of the 19th century that human affairs had been watched from the time of the world to space. No one could have dreamed that we were being scrutinized as someone with a microscope studies creatures that swarm and multiply in a drop of water. Few men even considered the possibility of life on other planets. And yet, across the gulf of space, minds immeasurably superior to ours regarded this Earth with envious eyes. And slowly and surely, they drew their plans against us.
Began to talk publicly about what I had seen in documents when I was attached to the Office of Naval Intelligence. Strange thing happened. As long as I agreed that we were being visited by extraterrestrial beings from outer space, and that these beings had entered into some kind of an illegal agreement with the United States government, as these documents that I had seen had stated, then I was pretty much welcomed and invited everywhere, and huge crowds come to talk to me. But a strange thing happened, folks. The very second that I began to equate extraterrestrials with New World Order, I came under the most vicious attacks that I have ever experienced in my life, anyone ever coming under for any reason. Now, this lends a tremendous amount of credibility to this connection, believe it or not. Totally adverse to what those who were doing the attacking wanted to happen. They wanted this connection not to be made. But it told me, because of the weight of the attacks, the severity of the attacks, the frequency of the attacks, that I was right on target. Right on target. And I make a good thing based on this, based on my research, based upon other things.
Writing, consulting work, lots of different technical problems. I'm a big fish in a small pond. Overall now, I've spoken at more than 600 colleges, 100 professional groups in all 50 states, 9 provinces, Finland, England, and Germany, and Italy next month. And my lecture is always, flying saucers are real. Underline the R, capitalize it. And some people don't like the word flying saucer. All flying saucers are UFOs. Very few UFOs are flying saucers. All great-grandfathers are men. Very few men are great-grandfathers. My focus is on flying saucers. Identifiable flying objects move me not at all. One of the major points I make, well, let me give you my four major conclusions right up front. And if you don't like them, you can leave now and save yourself the time. First, that the evidence is overwhelming that planet Earth is being visited by intelligently controlled extraterrestrial spacecraft. In other words, some, underline 18 times, some UFOs are alien spacecraft. Most are not, and I don't care about them. Second, and this will be the focus of today's little talk, the subject of flying saucers represents a kind of cosmic Watergate. That means to say that some few people within the governments of the United States and Canada and England and Russia and many other countries have known since 1947, when at least two crashed flying saucers and several alien bodies were recovered in New Mexico, that indeed some UFOs are alien spacecraft. Now you notice, when I say there's a cosmic water, but it doesn't mean everybody knows.
Thank you.
midnight on the 12th of August, a huge mass of luminous gas erupted from Mars and sped toward Earth. Across 200 million miles of void, invisibly hurtling toward us, came the first of the missiles that were to bring so much calamity to Earth. As I watched, there was another jet of gas. It was another missile, starting on its way. And that's how it was for the next 10 months. A flare spurting out from Mars. Light green, drawing a green mist behind it. A beautiful, but somehow disturbing sight. Ogilvy, the astronomer, assured me we were in no danger. He was convinced there could be no living thing on Earth, the most forbidding planet. Then came the night the first missile approached Earth. It was thought to be an ordinary falling star. The next day there was a huge crater in the middle of the column, and Ogilvy came to examine what lay there. A cylinder, 30 yards across, glowing hot, with faint sounds of movement coming from within. Suddenly the top began moving, rotating, unscrewing, and Ogilvy feared there was a man inside trying to escape. He rushed to the cylinder, but the intense heat stopped him before he could burn himself on the metal.
That I had uncovered, which led me to that connection. And I was called a conspiracy freak, a nut. And yet every single one of those predictions have come true. Not because I'm a prophet, not because I talk to God, because I can assure you that I don't, not because I'm a psychic or have any strange powers, but because I do an awful lot of studying. I'm an information freak. When I'm not talking to somebody or doing something else, my nose is in a book. I read so many books each week that sometimes I have to back off because all the information starts to mesh. And I don't know where I got it from.
2 feet of shining school projected when suddenly the lid fell off. Two luminous, disc-like eyes appeared above the rim. A huge, rounded bulk, larger than a bear, rose up slowly, glistening like wet leather. Its lipless mouth quivered and slapped, and snake-like tentacles writhed as the clumsy body teased and pulsated.
Where we're at and what's coming down the road, and I'm appalled that the rest of America is not on that cutting edge with me, because what's coming is not going to be anything that anyone in this room is going to like. Unless you're a bondage freak. And some of you may be. Now, I originally began to connect this with the secret societies of the world. And I wrote an entire chapter on my book, The Involvement of the Secret Societies in the New World Order. And I began forming an organization known as the Citizens Agency for Joint Intelligence, which has since become the largest and most successful intelligence gathering network under civilian control in the world. Far none. 2 years ago, we sent members out to infiltrate the secret societies and obtain the necessary degrees to reach a level where they would find out what was happening really. Because the only thing we have access to is what they have written, and they never write the truth because they are sworn by blood oath that they cannot divulge the truth of what they are really up to.
And an invisible ray leapt from man to man, and there was a bright glare, and each was instantly turned to fire. Every tree and bush became a massive flame of the touch of this savage, unearthly ray.
None of the objections raised to the first two conclusions by a small group of nasty, noisy negativists, not always nasty, but usually too noisy, stand up under careful scrutiny. Those arguments sound great, like from Carl Sagan, when you compare them with the data, the collapse of their own weight. Unfortunately, most often one doesn't get a chance to point out the fallacy of their pronouncements. Incidentally, this is a side note. 48 hours on the 20th of this month, which is what, Wednesday, I guess, we'll have a program on UFOs. And the last I heard, Carl Sagan was going to be on to give balance. Now, I never knew that ignorance balanced knowledge, but I guess that's the 48 hours approach, and there won't be anybody there I offered to point out the error of his way. And finally, fourth, being a shy, retiring guy, this is the biggest story of the millennium. Visits to planet Earth by alien spacecraft and successful cover-up of the government by the best case, the bottom to record. Okay, now,
I felt I was being toyed with, that when I was on the very verge of safety, this mysterious death would leap out me and strike me down. At last I reached Mabry Hill, and in the dim coolness of my home, I wrote an account for my newspaper before I sank into a restless fortune.
Okay. language can read it and understand it. One of those writers is Manly P. Hall. You people in L.A. have a tremendous opportunity because the Philosophical Society, founded by Manly P. Hall, is right here. It has one of the biggest libraries on the occult, the secret societies, and the esoteric teachings of this secret religion that goes all the way back to the dawn of the history of man and the worship of the sun that exists on the face of this planet. And yet, most of you are chasing lights in the sky. And waiting for the benevolent space brothers to rescue you.
Cameron from the pit and hurried to the railway station to buy the paper. Around me, the daily routine of life, working, eating, sleeping, was continuing serenely as it had for countless years. Continued hammering and stirring, sleepless, indefatigable, at work upon the machines they were making. Now and again a light, like the beam of a warship's searchlight, swept the common, and the heat ray was ready to follow.
It's been published lately, dating back to 1978. I'm the one who talked to primary witness, most of the primary witness, rather the first one around. And I little thought that I, 16 years later, would be talking about the same stuff and with new leads to follow up on. And I'm racing the undertaker, as you can imagine, since 47 years is a long time for adults who have been around. That's tonight. Today, I mean, there's no question that the recovery of the crash flying saucers and stuff was covered up, but that's not my focus today. What I do want to talk about in terms of the cosmic Watergate, and I will prove to you, not provide evidence, but prove to you, that agencies of the United States government are withholding information about flying saucers. That comes a little later. We need to go back in history to get some kind of feeling for this.
If you're all spinning around in circles and cul-de-sacs at the whims of people like William Moore and Stanton T. Friedman, so that you never understand what's really happening in this world or who's bringing it about. And that's the real intent of all those silly little pathetic arguments. And when someone comes up and wants to present to you a different point of view, is the information discussed? Is there an intelligent argument or conversation or dialogue conducted about the merits of the points of the argument? No. Don't listen to that person because he's a drunk. Folks, I know a lot of drunks, none of them are liars.
Anyone here?
Come in. Here, Princess.
Thank you.
What's happened?
They wiped us out. Hundreds dead, maybe thousands.
The heat ray?
The Martians. They were inside the hoods of machines they'd made. Massive metal things on legs. Giant machines that walked. They attacked us. They wiped us out.
Machines?
Fighting machines. Picking up men and bashing them against trees. Just hunks of metal. They knew exactly what they were doing.
There was another student that came last night.
Yes. As it looked bound for London.
Carrie. I had no dream there could be danger to Carrie and her father so many miles away. I must go to London at once.
And me. Have to report to headquarters. If there's anything left of it.
Thank you.
24 Liberators and B-17s. And here are these sleek, round saucer craft that seem to be able to station keep and move around these airplanes. And each side quite naturally thought that this was the other guy's latest new weapon system, and they're going to get shot down instantly, and what are they going to do about it? Not much. Nothing happened. And it was only after the war, when the pilots got together. I mean, that wasn't yours? No, we thought it was yours. Then they realized that, hey, wait a minute, something was going on here. In 1946, war ended in 45, 1946, there were well over 1,000 reports in Sweden of so-called ghost rockets, they were called. And there was great concern about what these were these fired from Russia, which is not too far from Sweden after all, were they German scientists that escaped? What was going on? And there were lots of these reports, and the New York Times carried a little article in August of 46 that the Swedish Defense Command met with two American representatives, General Jimmy Doolittle and General David Sarnoff. Both had been close to Ike during World War II. Now, the newspaper mentions their meeting with the Swedish Department of Defense, but nobody has ever seen a copy of any report, which surely would have been made. Ike was chief of staff at that time. When Jimmy was visited by an associate of mine a number of years ago, Jimmy Doolittle was one of my... Is that Morse code or something? The aliens have been formed us at something?
At 5 feet we came upon a team, but it was deserted. Is everybody dead? Not everybody. Look. Six cannons with gunners standing by.
Bows and arrows against the lightning. They haven't seen the heat wave yet.
Connect with. But I told you that the real purpose of my even ever discussing anything that I ever saw, or even trying to wake up anyone, was not to tell you about the reality or fantasy of extraterrestrial visitation to this earth, but was to wake you up to the reality of the imminent enslavement of the American people. The destruction of the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. The document, the only document in the history of the world that ever granted any man or woman that ever walked on this earth freedom. Ever. Blacks are being taught that the Constitution is not for them.
Explosion. The ground heaved. Windows shattered. Gusts of smoke erupted into the air.
Look! There they are! What did I tell you?
Steeple, striding over the pine trees and smashing them, walking engines of glittering metal. Each carried a huge hammer, and I realized with horror that I'd seen this awful thing before.
You see, it was blacks in Africa who captured those blacks and sold them into slavery. And it was ship owners who were not American, who carried those black slaves to these shores and sold them to the plantation owners. And it was white Americans who established the movement to free those black slaves, and it was the Constitution of the United States of America that allowed it to be done and gave them the freedom that they enjoy today.
And the ghostly, terrible heat ray struck the town. As it struck, all five fighting machines exulted, emitting deafening howls which roared like thunder.
Time, they could not have been citizens of free states because state constitutions specified they had to be free white property owners. All of those constitutions have been changed, allowing anyone born in any state in this country to be a free sovereign citizen, a king or queen in their own right, in a state as a state citizen. Now, the reason I bring this up is to show how we're being manipulated. Black people are being manipulated to believe that they don't belong in this country, and it is a lie. And that's just one example. Many people are being used to hide the truth. Many, many people. There was a courier riding through Bavaria one dark night who was struck by lightning off of his horse. He was carrying dispatches from the Bavarian Illuminati to another lodge. In these dispatches, which were opened and handed over to the Bavarian government, were word-for-word passages taken from the protocols of the Elders of Zion. Yet the Jews have been used to cover this up and brand anyone who would dare publish this plan as anti-Semitic. I am the only one who has opened up this plan, had the guts to publish it, and have had the guts to say that Jews didn't write it, but Jews are being used to cover it up, just as blacks are being used to help foment rebellion in this country by making them feel that they don't belong here. One of the greatest machinations of these people in charge who are bringing about the New World Order to slave all humanity, doesn't matter who you are, is the method of pitting us against each other so that while we're running around, weakening ourselves and destroying ourselves, fighting each other, they are very busy in the background enslaving us all.
temperature. So something was covered up, we don't know what, but there had to have been a report, oral or written or something. You don't go representing the government, talking to Defense Department people, and just sleep on it and forget it. The real cover-up, of course, began in 1947. The Roswell incident, so-called, which I'll talk about tonight, really it was the crash near Corona and another crash out in the plains of St. Augustine. Those were certainly covered up. And it was done very effectively and very quickly. At 12 o'clock noon from Roswell, New Mexico, a press release went out announcing that we'd recovered the wreckage of one of these crash discs that people had, one of these discs that people had been seeing for the last 2 weeks. That made evening papers from Chicago West on July 8, 1947. 4 hours later, out of Fort Worth, Texas, General Roger Amy, head of the 8th Air Force, of which the 509th at Roswell, New Mexico, was a part, put out the cover story that, sorry, it wasn't a disc at all, it was just a radar reflector from a weather balloon. That was true. Now, the initial news now knew...
simultaneously, decapitating a fighting machine. The Martian inside the hood was slain, splashed through the four winds, and the body, nothing now but an intricate device of metal, went whirling to destruction. As the other monsters advanced, people ran away blindly, the artillerymen among them. But I jumped into the water and hid until forced up to breathe. Now the guns spoke again, but this time the heat ray sent them to oblivion.
The cover story, 4 hours later, too late for all the papers except for the last edition of the Los Angeles Herald Express, the racing results. And it had Army recovers flying disc, and much smaller print, General Prince's radar weather gadget. By the next day, it's a 4 hour window of opportunity. By the next day, all the papers carried Ramey, General Roger Ramey, empties Roswell saucer, and until I got involved, 31 years later, the story was dead in the Georgia. Now, there's been a lot of research since that.
The heat ray swept across the river, scalded, half blinded and agonized. I staggered through leaping, hissing water towards the shore. I fell helplessly in full sight of the Martians, expecting nothing but death. The foot of a fighting machine came down close to my head, then lifted again as the four Martians carried away the debris of their fallen comrades. And I realized that by a miracle, I had escaped.
The common man or woman of any race, religion, or creed is not our enemy. They are people just like us. No matter what their skin color, no matter what their religion, no matter what language they speak, no matter where they live, the only thing that they really want out of life is to provide a safe, secure home for their family and for their children, enjoy the fruits of their labor, which they are entitled to, and have some modicum of a happy life. I don't believe that there's anyone who would challenge that. So then why do we spend most of our time trying to destroy it? No war was ever fought because the people wanted to go to war. It's because the leaders manipulated.
For 3 days, I fought my way along roads packed with refugees, the homeless, burdened with boxes and bundles containing their valuables. All that was of value to me was in London. But by the time I reached their little red brick house, Carrie and her father were gone.
We must mature. We must become kings and queens in our own right, not just say that we are. We must understand these things. We must stop hating each other. The answer for white Christian separatists, what's called identity Christian, is not a nation of whites here, next to a nation founded by Louis Farrakhan and the Islamic nation of just blacks, because on that part of that will always be war.
answer is not a Jewish death toll. The answer is rejecting, is not rejecting the rest of society. Cultural. Boys. But yet, demanding that a guest in your house wear the yarmulke? If they're not of your faith. Now understand me, ladies and gentlemen, I am for one thing and one thing. Truth first. Humanity second.
Autumn's golden gown needs to kick our way. You always love this time of year. The fallen leaves lie on this earth now, 'cause you're not here. 'Cause you're not here.
Population panicked and ran, and I was swept along with them, aimless and lost without Carrie. Finally, I headed eastward for the ocean and my only hope of survival, a boat out for England.
Like the thunder of trees, you came to love me. Like a leaf on a breeze, you blew.
General Ramey's chief of staff took the call from Washington, telling him to cover it up in no uncertain terms. Get the meat of the press off our backs, send some of the records up here, and don't ever talk about it again. That's an order. Do I need to put it in writing? He said. Because that was Clemence McMullen, who was really the acting head of the Strategic Air Command, of which they were a part. His boss, who knows, I suppose it would have been the president plus the head of the Air Force. One hopes so. We don't know what the exact chain was. There was a lot of message traffic we have never seen. But there's no question that the call came from McMullen, and I got that from DuBose firsthand. It's Colonel Thomas Everson DuBose. McMullen was one of the old people. And of course, when
more and more people joined the painful exodus. Sad, weary women, their children stumbling in the streets with tears, their men bitter and angry, the rich rubbing shoulders with beggars and outcasts. Dogs snarled and whined, the horses' bits were covered with foam, and here and there were wounded soldiers, as helpless as the rest of the people. Wading up the Thames, cutting through bridges as though they were paper. Waterloo Bridge, Westminster Bridge. One appeared above Big Ben. Suffered together. This was no disciplined march. It was a stampede without order and without a goal. 6 million people unarmed and unprovisioned driving headlong. It was the beginning of the rout of civilization, of the massacre of mankind.
How much it hurts to hear it is the only reality that we can live by and ensure comfortable future.
And if the truth hurts, and if the truth is bad, we can only make it better by acknowledging what the truth is and working for that better future together as humanity. Not as blacks and whites. And tell me, folks, what in the hell is an Afro-American?
So safely on board, straight into the eyes of my beloved Carrie. At sight of me, she began to fight her way along the back deck to the gangplank. At that very moment, it was raised, and I caught a last glimpse of her despairing face as the crowd swept me away from her.
Like the sun through the trees.
You hear that? I know somebody's confused. Are you an African or are you an American? And I'm not trying to insult blacks. I understand that you are hungry for a history, for something to identify with. And I understand that hunger because my parents were in the military. I never had a hometown. I hunger with you. I don't have any place where I can go. That's the school I went to in the third grade, and old Mrs. Jones lives down there. I can go say hello to her. I know what you're going through. I know that you feel like you don't have any roots, but you have to decide, are you African or are you American? You belong in the state of Israel or do you belong to America? Are you a German Aryan? If so, go to Germany! Or are you an American? It's funny that we have in this country the penultimate of the gift of all the people who have ever lived upon this planet. And we're pissing on it.
The steamer began to move slowly away, but on the landward horizon appeared the silhouette of a fighting machine. Another came, and another, striding over hills and seas, plunging far out to sea and blocking the exit of the steamer. Between them lay the silent, gray, ironclad Thunder Child. Slowly it moved toward shore, then with a deafening roar and whoosh of spray, it swung about and drove at full speed toward the waiting Martians.
There were ships of shapes and sizes scattered out along the bay.
And I thought, two-star general or just colonel, you do what you're told. So that was very effective. Now, the cover-up kept on, but in very different, subtle ways all through the years. Project Blue Book Special Report 14, the largest study ever done, covered 3,201 sightings, issued in 1955, but never distributed by the Air Force. This work was done by Battelle Memorial Institute in Columbus, Ohio, under contract to Project Blue Book. Here's a report that covers 3,200 sightings, categorizations, quality evaluations, 240 charts, tables, graphs, maps, chock full of information. They didn't distribute the report. They put out a press release in which the Secretary of the Air Force said, on the basis of this report, we believe that no objects such as those properly described as flying saucers have overflown the United States. Even the unknown 3% could have been identified as conventional phenomena or illusions, unquote.
The Martians released their black smoke, but the ship sped on, cutting down one of the tripod tickets. Instantly, the others raised their heat rays and melted the Thunder Child's valley of rock.
Painful. Let me give you some ideas of what I'm talking about, folks. How many of you were in Waco, Texas? I was. I was in Waco, Texas because I knew from day one something was terribly wrong. Because I was watching my television set and here's what I saw. I saw a church under attack by federal forces. And it turned out to be the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms. And then I heard the leader of the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms conduct a press conference where he said, this church has murdered 4 of our agents and wounded 16 more. And the reason that we're here is because a foreign source reported through the State Department that this church was going to commit mass suicide. You see, something in my head clicks because I understand the Constitution. I know what's happening. Most people don't. They're what I call sheeple, not people.
couldn't be explained is that there wasn't enough data, is that both those statements are totally false. The unknowns were 21%, not 3%. They were completely separate from the ones for which there was insufficient information. But the press bought it hook, line, and sinker. Incidentally, a quality evaluation showed the better the quality, the more likely to be an unknown. A statistical comparison between the unknowns and the knowns, the probability of unknowns are just misknown.
The steamer had reached the misty horizon, and Carrie Ann was safe. But the Thunder Child had vanished forever, taking with her man's last hope of victory. The leaden sky was lit by green flashes, cylinder following cylinder, and no one and nothing was left now to fight them. The Earth belonged to the Martians.
Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you've enjoyed tonight's presentation. Tomorrow night, part two of the musical War of the Worlds. Good night, ladies and gentlemen, and God bless you all. And remember, that giant metal machine tripod in your town square is your own water tower.